what is an object in this app? G.f. And so action should satisfy G. If I had a point and I moved it already, that should be the same thing as just moving it by the composition. And if I hit it with the identity element of the group, it shouldn't move at all. The identity element should be the identity symmetry. So this is all G flows. So we just have some, we use an object, we have some group of symmetries, it's moving around. Cool. What are some examples? Let's make it a little concrete. Kind of keep 4-ish examples running at all times, and we can like think about how these examples relate to later notions. Probably the easiest group to wrap our heads around is the integers. The integers are a really nice group. What's a really easy space to visualize? How about the circle? S1 is literally just the unit circle. Unit circle. Pretend that's a circle. And then the action is going to be given by irrational rotation. So in this case, since Z is generated by additively generated by 1, I'm going to tell you what a one-step transformation is. And one step of the transformation is going to rotate the whole circle alpha of any radians. That will be some irrational rotations. You could think about rational ones, but we'll think about irrational ones for reasons yet to come. So this is a flow. Since Z is a discrete group, to check the continuity, you just need to know that each group element acts continuously on the circle. And these rotations are clearly continuous. They're just rotating the circle. The same space can admit many different flow structure. So I could change the group, for instance. Let's change the group. G is going to be Romeo plus S1. What is the little plus here doing? So Romeo S1, that's just all of the homeomorphisms of the circle. The plus means no flips, orientation preserving homeomorphism of S1. This is not a discrete group anymore. This is going to carry the compact open topology. In this case, compact open topology has a general definition, but since G is just this nice group of homeomorphisms, how far away is a typical group element from doing nothing? Well, I look at every single point. Every single point moves by some amount. I look at the supremum of those amounts, and that'll be the distance of this group element from the identity. And that'll be a nice right invariant. You declare that to generate the right invariant metric. If I want to compare G and H, I just say, where does G send this point X? Where does H send this point X? Compare those distances. Look for the largest such thing. So that's a topological group. And then X is going to be S1. And A is going to be just the evaluation map. So now this 2 prime, this is going to be the same as 2, but I could have just kept a discrete topology. That would be fine. Same as 2, but G So the contact open topology is the, this is actually the coarsest, it's one way to define the compact open topology on a homeomorphism group of a space. It's the coarsest thing that makes this evaluation continuous. So it's the coarsest thing we could possibly do to get this to be a flow, but I could take finer things, and so just the discrete topology would be a finer thing. Alright, so that's 1, 2, 2 prime, and then, oh, maybe I'll put 3, we all know what an action is, I'm going to put 3 above. Just to have everything on that part of the board so I can keep those examples. And example 3. This is just to show, I mean, so the circle is kind of a, it's a manifold, it's a kind of easy to visualize object. These things can be a bit more abstract. So let's let G be the integers again. Now the space is going to be the set of all bi-infinite 0, 1 strings. Just zeros and ones going to the left and right forever. I give this the product topology, so that's going to be nice and compact. And then what is the action going to do? Again, since it's the integers, I just have to tell you what the generating transformation does. It's going to be the shift. So I have a string of zeros and ones going in both directions forever. I can bump it to the left and right by however many integers I want to do. So that's a bit more, maybe a bit more abstract. That comes from symbolic dynamics. All right, so these are 4 examples of flows. I wrote a remark here. Do I want to say this remark? Yeah, I'll say this remark. It's just a good thing to know. I'll say a remark and then I'm going to erase it right away. So we saw a little bit of, we can mess with the topology of the group a little bit. In general, what is the thing that we need to get a flow? So X, say that X is a compact space. And if G is a topological group, a useful thing to keep in mind is that G flows are the same thing as continuous homomorphisms from the group, so phi A, so say that a G flow A, be the same thing as a continuous homomorphism phi A, that'll go from the group to homeo X, where this is compact open. So how can I tell if something is a G flow? It should give me a continuous homomorphism. What is phi of A? Each group element is doing something to the space. Just output what it does to the space. That will be a homomorphism. And so this makes it a bit clearer that if I have some topology on G where this is a flow, I can make it finer. Still be continuous, but still be flow. But anyways, this isn't terribly central to what I want to do. So what I want to do is I want to discuss some properties that, I want to discuss some properties that a flow might have. And then we're going to zoom in on one of those properties and we're going to construct a universal flow with that property. So what are some properties we might be interested in? Some properties of flows. So I'll call this 0 because it's pretty rare. point transitive. This means that for any pair of points, there is a group element sending one to another. So let's think. So of these four examples, who can tell me which ones are point transitive? Quiet.
Two and three.
Two and two prime. My numbering is wacky, but yeah. So homeomorphisms of the unit circle, I can easily, here's a point on the unit circle, here's a point on the unit circle, I can just rotate to get from one point to the other. It turns out, neither one nor three are going to be point transitive. So the irrational rotation looks kind of promising because I can sure get pretty close, but the orbits here can be countable, and the circle is uncountable. So that's one obstacle. And up here, I guess saying obstacle works. Countable group, uncountable space, you're not going to be point transitive. But yeah, homeo-S is huge. So that works. Well, point transitive almost never happens, so let's weaken it a little bit. Minimal, i.e. every orbit is dense. So, zero is asking for one orbit. Everything is in the same orbit. One is weakening that a little bit. I no longer require everything to be in the same orbit, but just that every orbit sees most of the space. So, do we get any... So, 2 and 2 prime will still be minimal. Do we get any new members in the minimal club? I see some heads saying yes. Yes, irrational rotation is a good example of a minimal flow. Here's a point, say that I want to get into this open interval. I just have to, I guess I should compute, I just need to figure out some number of multiples of alpha that get me into here mod 1, and you can do that. So this is minimal. This is not minimal. What's an easy way of seeing that? There are some really stupid strings, like the zeros. Like I could send zeros off in both directions forever, and that will never... If I have a neighborhood that says, put a 1 in this spot, you're going to have trouble reaching that.
If you only think about the aperiodic strings, you...
Ooh, so those won't be... that won't be closed in general. But we're going to do one further weakening, which will save number 3. 2. This is topologically point transitive. I.e., so one said every orbit was dense, i.e., so two is going to weaken that to say some orbit is dense. So it's clear that that's a weakening of 1, which is in turn a weakening of 0. 2 is the weakest of these notions. So 1, 2, and 2 prime will still all be topologically point transitive. And now I claim that 3 is also going to be point transitive. So can anyone think, how might you need to find some string whose orbit is dense? How do you do that?
Joe, can you take some string that just contains every finite...
Yeah, neighborhoods are going to be described by finite patterns of zeros and ones. And we have infinitely much room, so I just need to type every possible 0-1 pattern on some string. I That's exactly what you do. Alright, so what we're going to do, so those are examples. What we're going to do for the rest of the talk is we're going to focus on number two. So goal for rest of the talk. Construct maybe one part of this goal is a definition, which is a little bit poor organization, but a definition, an ambit, or I guess there's a group involved, the G ambit is a pair just some G flow, and X will be topologically point transitive as witnessed by this little point X naught. So I declared a point of interest with dense orbit. So what we're going to show, theorem, there is a greatest G ambit. So what this means is that there's going to be a, so there is some ambit. It's usually denoted S of G for historical reasons. Pierre Samuel was the person responsible for this stuff originally, and I at this point, so this is going to be a G ambit, and then given any other G ambit, there's going to be a unique map, which what are the things we want our map to satisfy? I should have defined some sort of category of G ambits and ambit maps. But an ambit map is continuous. It respects the G action. It respects the point I told you about, so it should send this point to that point. The uniqueness actually just follows from that last fact. I sent this point to this other point. We know that it has to be G equivariant, and they both have dense orbits. So, if I want to know where, I have some other point P in here, I want to know where phi sends it, well, the orbit of 1 is going to cluster around P. I know where everything in the orbit of 1 goes, so I know where that's going to cluster over here. Yeah, let's spend the rest of today constructing this thing.
I'm not really stupid questions.
Okay.
You've used the words minimal and greatest, but I don't have the intuition for why the minimal and greatest. Especially this one, because I would think of the initial object of the category as being the least thing. So why is that called the greatest thing?
Oh, because we're topologists and not category theorists. Yes, this is an initial object. Yeah, so
in what sense is it great? Like, why is it bigger?
Oh, so given if I had some other why not, and some map here, I can complete the diagram like that. What the reason that's not the right thing to draw is because all these maps are unique. There's a unique map between any pair of objects, which kind of simplifies the picture. So the simplest thing to say is that there is an arrow from this object.
Okay. And in what sense is a minimal flow minimal?
Oh, that's just in a in a Zorn's lemma sense. It contains no proper subflows.
Oh, okay, cool.
And here's another annoying one. So the universal minimal one, it is unique up to a G-flow isomorphism, but not unique up to a unique G-flow isomorphism. That is an annoying wrinkle. if you care about these things. And this is a good stopping point.
Cool.
Sorry, everybody.
Well, no worries.
You never messed up.
But yeah, that actually, and so the non-uniqueness, so NGs can have lots of automorphisms. The automorphisms screw up your uniqueness. And so a lot of proofs that you want to write down, it's like, oh crap, I don't know that that's the arrow I have. Yeah, it dives into, it's a lot to do with like the algebra and stuff, where you get the this is actually a very natural, and I have a whole bunch of ambits. So I is some giant index set. Each one of these things is an ambit. We're going to cook up a product. So what I can do is I can look at Z. It'll be a subset of the product of the spaces. But what is Z going to be? I don't want to take the whole thing. I'm going to take the orbit closure of G acting on the designated point. So I have a designated point in each coordinate that gives me a designated point in the product. I want that point to have dense orbit, so I'm just going to pass it down to a subspace where it does have dense orbit. That's why I have to pass it down to this subspace. This behaves like a product in the category of G ambit. And so what's kind of cool is, remark, there is a set, this is a bit of a logical bugaboo, there's a set of representatives for isomorphism types of ambits. What this really amounts to saying is that ambits can't get too complicated. Why is that? It's really this dense orbit. So you have your, in particular, that provides a map of your group into this, a priori, it could be a huge compact space, but it can't be too huge because your group has a fixed size. Say that your group has size kappa, where kappa is some cardinal. We get a map with dense image. So what does that tell us? So if X is an ambit, so X has dense subset size kappa. That tells us that X can't be too big. Cardinality of X is less than equal to 2 to the kappa. I mean, it's pretty large, but it's bounded. Your ambits aren't going to get bigger than this. So I can, with enough of a initial fragment of set theory, you can see all the ambits that are going to show up. So what that allows you to do, let's take a set of representatives for all the isomorphism types of ambits and take their ambit product. That is, by construction, by absolute overkill construction, a universal ambit. We just smooshed all the ambits together, yes?
When you use the word ethic product, do you like, does this connect to anything other category?
Yeah, it's the product in the category of ambits. The category of ambits is a little bit it's a bit easier than a lot of other categories because there's at most one arrow between any pair of objects. So that's one way of exhibiting this greatest GM, but it's not very useful. Like, I have no idea what it looks like. I want to actually construct this thing. So, at least in the case of a discrete group, let's try to construct this thing. I'll leave up my example. Those are nice. And as I indicated in the abstract, pointer filters are awesome. So, without further ado, let X be a set. A filter on X is a collection of subsets. So it is a collection of subsets of X, so that it's non-trivial, which usually matters to these two statements. It's upward closed. Filters are a notion of largeness. If I have something I'm declaring to be large and I make it bigger, that's still going to be large. If I have two large things and they intersect, that should still be large. That's a filter. There's a bonus property. So there's two equivalent ways to define what an ultrafilter is. These are equivalent definitions. So it satisfies 1, 2, 3, and 4. There's a purely combinatorial way. So if A is a subset of X, an ultrafilter, let me say U, script U, either A is in, or complement. So ultrafilters are a notion of largeness that are very opinionated. Ultrafilters have an opinion about everything. Everything is either large or small. There's no medium. The equivalent definition for prime is that U is maximal with regard to satisfying 1, 2, 3. That's sort of the more abstract way of saying it. So ultrafilters are maximal filters. Ultrafilters are really opinionated filters. So you may have seen ultrafilters before. They show up in like functional analysis, they show up in model theory. But most of the time, you think about like one ultrafilter letting you take some sort of, it's a particular way of, like, I have some countable set of things I want to grab a cluster point. An ultrafilter is a good way of letting you grab a cluster point. So what we're gonna do today, we're not gonna worry about one ultrafilter, we're gonna worry about all of them. So beta x is the space of all ultrafilters. So some things I should remark. You can identify X as a subset via taking principal filters. If I have a point in X, the collection of all subsets containing that point is an ultrafilter. But there's going to be a lot of other stuff too. There's going to be stuff that things that are not principal. So a topology on this thing. What we're going to do is a basic open set. We're going to be able to form a bar. Those ultrafilters that contain the set A, where A is going to range over all subsets of X. This notation might be a little bit confusing at first, because a bar kind of looks like the closure of A. And that's not an accident. Under this identification, a bar is the closure of A. So this is a zero-dimensional space. It has a basis of closed sets. These are all open. This is a... I don't think I have time to prove it. This is a compact Hausdorff space. Hausdorff is really easy. Compactness, probably the easiest way to do it is through the finite intersection property characterization of compactness. So, if I have a collection of basic closed sets, this basis for the open sets is also a basis for the closed sets, because A is also, via this identification. So, basis for closed sets also. If you have some collection then with the finite intersection property, then the sets that you're mentioning form a filter, extended to an ultrafilter that's a point in the intersection. Alright, so this is the key property about beta x, the magic triangle. Those of you who have seen me give GSS talks before have probably heard me pontificate at length about the magic triangle, but it's the best triangle you can ever draw. Theorem, magic triangle. So say that let Y be compact Hausdorff, everything is Hausdorff. And let F from X to Y be any function. X is just a set, remember, so there's no... It's a discrete topological space, if you don't think of it that way. So any function. So what are we going to do? Here's X, here's Y, here's F, here's the inclusion, and then here is the last side of the magic triangle. So there is a unique continuous making the triangle work. So let's prove this. I'm going to erase my examples. The uniqueness just follows. I should remark that the principal members are dense, just because. If I have a basic open set like this and a member of A, that principal ultrafilter, A is a set containing that member of A, so that would be a principal ultrafilter in there. So we have this dense, we know what's going on a dense subset of beta x, so we just have to argue that there is an extension and an associate. So how do we do this? Let's let y be an element of y. I can consider, say that p concentrates at y. If for every open neighborhood of y, f inverse of u, that's going to be back here in x, and p has an opinion about it. So let's suppose that it's large for p. This is just a definition. So p thinks it wants to go to y if this happens. This is going to be a template for defining our function. For every p, concentrates at some y is this suppose not? Y is compact, and every point in y is a little neighborhood around it where something bad happens. So let's just grab a finite cover of these bad things. UK. Open cover so f inverse of u I is not in p, but it's a cover of y, so the union is the whole thing. Every point maps to somewhere. So that's the map for one of these implies. And I didn't spell this out explicitly, but this is going to be a problem in regards to 4. I guess along with 1. X is in there. You repeatedly apply that, I guess, k many times. One of these has to be inside p, and it's not. Let's just prove this right away. Let's go down here. Every p. Concentrates at a unique point, or y. This is really easy. Here's y. Here's two possible points, y1 and y2. If they are different, let's put little disjoint neighborhoods around them, because everything is Hausdorff. These have disjoint preimages, and so you're never going to have disjoint things that p thinks are both large. That's bad. So that's our rank. You have to do a little bit of fiddling to check that it is continuous, but I'm just going to say, yes, it's continuous. Why is it continuous? Because it's sort of the obvious thing that you wrote down. That's kind of the way a lot of these proofs go with ultrafilter spaces. Like, there's just one way to write down a possible function, and then it's going to work. Alright, let's get an ambit out of this. So if I have a discrete group, so say G is a discrete group, uh, Then theta g 1g is an ambit. Yay. I have to tell you what the flow is. We have a space, but where's the flow? I'm going to send g. It's pretty easy. So if A is a subset of the group, G is a group element, P is an ultrafilter, I need to tell you when A is a member of G dot P, and it's really the only thing that can happen. P is a collection of subsets of the group. G is just going to move them around by left translation, so this is definitely if G inverse of A. This works. This is it's continuous because I can ask about this basic open condition by asking about this basic open condition. That's continuity. G is discrete, so to check continuity of the whole thing, you just need to check each one group at a time. So why is it the greatest ambit? Well, because of the magic triangle. Let's x naught be another g ambit. So let f go from g to x by f of g. I'm just going to look at what g does to the distinguished point. That's sort of the only thing we one could possibly write down. And that's the only part of the map we could possibly know how to define ahead of time. We know what's happening on this orbit. So the orbit tells us to do that. And then we're going to extend f to all beta g. That's going to be continuous. You have to check the magic triangle does not buy you g equivariance. You have to check that. But it works. F is G equivariant on this dense subset. So if you get the continuous extension, it'll have to be G equivariant. So that is that's the greatest G ambit. It's this space of ultrafilters. Which is still, I mean, it's kind of abstract still, but it's maybe a bit less abstract than just saying multiply all the ambits together. This is at least an object. We know what it is. So yeah, I will not have time to talk about G not discrete, but you can speculate. What would you do if G is not discrete? What's the problem? Maybe I'll say, if G is not discrete, you have to worry about joint continuity of the action. So if G had some topology, you can write down the same action, in general, is not joint continuous when G is not discrete. But I will say there is a workaround. It's just beta G is the wrong compactification to use. So you can think of this this beta operation is turning, in this case, a discrete space into a compact space in the freest way possible. And so when G has some other topology, that's you don't just want to regard it as a set. You need to remember that it started off with a topology. And then there's a few extra wrinkles too, but it's fun. All right, that's it.
Is there any questions or comments?
How simple is the simplest example you can think of for G that's topologized?
Oh, but still easy to know?
No, that serves as a counterexample to this.
Oh, any non-trivial topological group.
Any non-trivial topological group breaks this.
Mm-hmm. One case where it's easy say that G is a compact group, then SG will just be the group itself. That's kind of on the other extreme end of, like, being trivial. Like, compact groups are really, really simple dynamically. Anytime it acts on another compact space, it has to be like a group act, like a group quotient.
What about when G's like locally compact?
Oh, locally compact groups are disgusting. You have Veach's theorem that locally compact groups admit free flows.
Mm-hmm.
So that's going to tell you that S, MG is not metrizable, so SG is not metrizable. So SG is going to be a huge, huge thing.
So there's no, like, concrete description?
There is. If you were in the logic seminar today, that's sort of the hint as to where things go. You have to, like, consider, like, nearness.
Okay,
and
but that's the best
like that.
Description.
As far as I know.
Okay.
Alright, let's bet in here again.